Now we are all here. Good morning. Very much welcome. My name is Per Wissén. I work at the Swedish House of Finance at the Stockholm School of Economics, and this seminar series, this Finance Panel, is a joint production between Swedish House of Finance and SNS. And today we will discuss the state of the Swedish economy in general, basically, and above all, maybe the vulnerabilities in the financial sector in Sweden. And the reason for having this discussion today is that 2 weeks ago, roughly, two reports were published by the International Monetary Fund, the IMF. One, an annual report called an Article 4 consultation is the word, done annually, as annual reports are, on the state of the Swedish economy, but then also a financial sector, part of a financial sector assessment plan. Program. I had to learn this, FSAP. Every fifth year, the IMF comes here and goes through the situation in the financial sector, looking for, well, strength and weaknesses, I suppose, but vulnerabilities in the sector and things that can be improved. So with those as a background, today we will have Craig Beaumont from the IMF here presenting these two reports, sort of a 30-minute summary of the contents of these reports. And then we have invited Jesper, Rangvid from the Copenhagen Business School to, well, act as sort of an opponent or discussant, and above all, maybe drawing on the Danish experience. A number of the difficulties we have had here, we have here, are our problems that Denmark has gone through a couple of years before, and see what we can learn from those. And so that will be two 30-minute sessions. Then we will have a 10-minute break to sort of have more air in the room and a cup of coffee. And after that, we will have a panel up here, and I will come back to the people on the panel, but Erik Tedén will be there. We had a third report published yesterday, the stability report from Finansinspektionen. And so sort of Christmas came early this year. We had sort of three of these reports in a short spell. And Anna Breman and Peter Englund and Hans Lindberg will be on the panel, and then there will be opportunities for you to give your comments, your views, questions, whatever, and we'll have a dialogue with the panel and the speakers and you after the break. So that will be the program for today. So once again, very much welcome, and please, Craig, the floor is yours.
Okay, thanks so much, Pierre, and I'm very impressed that so many people turn up on a chilly morning at 8 o'clock in the morning. Very happy to present our annual Article 4 consultation, and we actually call it a financial system stability assessment. So let's start with the normal macroeconomic outlook. We see after this very strong growth in 2015-16 that the economy should cool off a bit in 2017-18. And the main thing that's slowing down is investment, which has been growing around 7% and should ease, but we think it should ease back to about 4%. And that's a combination of the monetary and fiscal impulses the economy has been enjoying fading out a bit, and capacity constraints starting to bite, especially maybe in construction, though I do see maybe there's still some momentum into 2017. Of course, economic projections have lots of uncertainties around them, and we identify just a couple of the main risks up there. The first one, the obvious one, is, you know, slow growth in the world, and especially maybe in Europe, and the current issue of the day that we see endemic across the world is politics. More specific for Sweden, we have a concern about a possible period of weak consumption growth, could be triggered by interest rates normalizing, house prices falling. Now, to me, at least, this doesn't seem to be an immediate proximate risk, but it's something that is a risk maybe that just keeps on rising as house prices and household debt rise. And I think we saw some nice research from Martin Flodden on just how much interest rates impact consumption of highly indebted households. They've become quite sensitive. So against that quite pleasant outlook, the question for Sweden is really how to make that last, how to sustain quite solid growth. And we identify four priorities. We think, you know, really you need a balanced approach. There's no simple single issue to deal with. There's a number of things to deal with. So we have the raising inflation to target over time. It's not because, you know, 1% inflation or 2% inflation is so much better than 1%, but it gives you the room to normalize interest rates, to make monetary policy available if shocks hit the economy. Of course, with the International Monetary Fund, it's mostly fiscal. We have to protect the fiscal health. And we link that to refugee integration. But in this presentation, I won't go into the details of refugee integration in the interest of time. Probably I'll spend most time on containing household debt and housing vulnerabilities, and especially on the last topic of ensuring the resilience of Sweden's large financial system. So let's turn to monetary policy. I'm trying to move through this reasonably quickly. You all know very well that the Riksbank resorted to unconventional monetary instruments from early 2015, and that followed a quite sharp drop in inflation expectations and also moves by advanced economy central banks, especially the ECB, towards unconventional instruments. And so what's the impact? Being some countries have doubts that unconventional monetary policies actually work, but in Sweden we see quite a substantial fall in the whole yield curve, and that filters through into the cost of wholesale funding for the banks. And because they're hedging those costs, the right-hand chart shows you that after hedging, the banks are enjoying a significant fall in their wholesale funding costs. And my colleague, Rima Turk, we mentioned this working paper number, she has done quite extensive analysis of bank profitability and shows that this reduction in the cost of wholesale funding has done a great deal to cushion the banks against negative interest rates. So what's the outlook? We have to think about inflation, what's happening with inflation. I tend to prefer to look at this harmonized index of consumer prices rather than the CPI, and that's averaging about 1.1% so far this year. And a range of indicators are pointing to resource utilization of the economy finally getting a little bit above normal levels, and a range of models which suggest, you know, that's going to feed into inflation from 2017. You can see there's lots of uncertainty around that, but it's a range of things are suggesting it's heading upwards eventually next year. What we worry about is maybe things will be slower than normal because euro area wages are so sluggish. Even in Germany, which has got the lowest unemployment in the euro area, wages are running about 2.25%. So very modest wage growth. And that seems to spill over into wage formation in Sweden. So the takeoff of inflation, wage price setting may be a bit slower than normal. So we think the outlook is for a gradual rise in inflation, and in that sense, monetary policy has to keep on, stay the course, remain expansionary for some time, and wait for inflation to show clear signs of moving up before starting to unwind the monetary easing. And we would encourage to take a fairly symmetric approach to the outlook for inflation, willing to accept some risk of it going above target when you're formulating monetary policy. Now, even after reducing interest rates to minus 0.5%, we still see some more room to reduce interest rates, and we also see more room to extend and broaden asset purchases. So if there was a setback in inflation expectations, the Riksbank still has ammunition, which it should and can use. The last point about foreign exchange intervention seems to be not quite so relevant these days where the krona is, but let me mention that we discourage foreign exchange intervention. Sweden's enjoying a reasonable surplus, and we think the krona is already a little bit undervalued, so this is not really the time to do foreign exchange intervention. Fiscal policy. I think I can be quite brief about fiscal policy. We don't see a big issue. In fact, we very much support the approach the government has taken in terms of accommodating the increase in spending that's related to migration. The whole point of having a very strong fiscal position is that you don't need to adjust spending and revenues to offset temporary shocks. These adjustments have costs. And you get the side benefit, a little bit of support for growth at a time when monetary policy could do with some support. Wouldn't overstate the benefits. I mean, we have roughly a half percentage point of GDP stimulus. Sweden's a small open economy. It's not going to add that much to growth. Let's look forward. There's a new surplus target, 0.3% of GDP. And we very much support that. Even with no policy change, the structural balance is expected to reach about 0.6% of GDP in 2019. So you don't need actual consolidation measures to get to the target. In fact, there's a little bit of room going forward, and we would encourage that that room be used in a way which has sort of the most long-term fiscal benefits, which we think would be further assistance for migrant integration. You know, enhancing employment of migrants will have a big long-term payoff, and housing supply is another issue that could have a significant long-term benefit. So let's turn to one of the main topics for this meeting, which is housing and household debt vulnerabilities. Just a little bit of background on the housing market. There we saw a welcome slowing in house price inflation. Coincidentally, our last visit was about here. But I'm sure it's more to do with the expectation of the amortization requirement coming in. But if we, you know, we've got a little bit of data now since the amortization requirement came in, which is the right-hand chart. And so while the prices, especially apartment prices, seemed to stabilize before the requirement came in the last few months they seem to be picking up again. So I'm not going to attract a high confidence to saying there's a renewed housing surge, but it's something to be cautious about. Now, the other side of the coin is household debt. Our outlook is household debt is going to keep on rising, and there's two stories that will take you to that conclusion. One is to look at the balance sheet ratios, debt in terms of total assets, debt relative to housing values. Both those numbers have come down. They're a little bit below historical norms. That suggests the household sector has room to re-leverage to what it's normally the normal degree of leverage. And the other story is very simple, that house prices are very high, and the new borrowers borrow more, and as the market turns over, you just ratchet up the debt level. So overall debt's likely to keep on rising, and perhaps more worryingly is what's happening to the composition, or what's likely to happen to the composition of that debt. If we look in recent years, there has been some migration from lower debt ratios into high debt ratios. It doesn't look too dramatic in terms of the population. On the right-hand side, we have the new borrowers. How much are they borrowing? And that's shifting much more rapidly. So I think what this implication is, there's that migration that we see so far will probably speed up going forward. So we talked a lot about house prices and debt, and usually we jump straight into macroprudential measures, but I want to do something different. I want to say really the real problem for Sweden is in the housing market. And this is very probably well known here, but it's not really discussed so much in other countries, and our board finds this quite interesting. And we have very much the same list of recommendations we had last year. I'm sure the same recommendations have been made for many years. It's all, the critical thing is to make sure land is available for development. I think rent controls are a big part of the issue. People have no option. They wait so long for renting a place, they have to buy a place. They have to borrow. They don't have an option. So that's a big part of the problem. Then there's the tax side. We just had a blog in the mid-November about the the great distortion, the tax favorable treatment of debt. And consistent with that, we've continued to favor a phase out of deductibility of interest. In an ideal world, the property tax is a progressive tax that would be reinstated, or at least the ceilings would be raised. So that we can't really underemphasize that the fundamental solution to the household debt issue is really a housing market reform. But, these types of reforms of housing supply and taxes, they take time to implement, they take time to phase in. So what do you do in the meantime? So we suggest, we recognize that actually Sweden has done quite a range of macroprudential measures. You've got the LTV ceiling, you've got the risk weight floor, more recently you've got the amortization. But if you work through all those measures, they don't really hold back an accumulation of debt that's driven by rising prices. You need some other tool to reinforce the measures you already have. And macroprudential policies are a work in progress. The currently available idea is a debt-to-income limit. I was talking to Governor Patrick Honohan, who adopted one of these in Ireland, and he says, look, the LTV is about protecting the banks. If there's a failure, it controls their loss. The DTI is about protecting the households, limiting the risk of distress. So this says it in a slightly longer way. We're a little bit cautious about going into the details of implementation, because it's a new area. There are options out there that can be developed. On the timing side, and we hear the authorities saying, look, we need to assess the impact of amortization, and that's very reasonable. At the same time, our sense is the conditions are there for a further rise in prices and debt. and that urges timely action. So there's a bit of a tension. But we come out on the side of timely action, which doesn't mean by the end of the year, but it means timely. It's not so well defined. Last topic is the financial sector. So we have this 5-yearly financial stability assessment. So it's only for systemic countries. And why is Sweden considered to be systemic from a global perspective? Two main things. One, the banking system is just big. And it's partly big because you have substantial foreign operations. So you're not only big, it's interconnected into the Nordic Baltic region. And the other side of the coin is its interconnectedness into the non-bank financial sector and into the foreign wholesale markets, which this right-hand chart points out. So it's big and it's highly interconnected. It's systemic. And now that I can't do justice to the work of the FSAP team. It was led by Martin Chiak from our Monetary and Capital Markets Department. He had a dozen financial sector experts helping, and the authorities provided a lot of support for all that work. It was a very thorough assessment. I certainly can't go into insurance, market infrastructures, securities markets, but I don't want to suggest that those recommendations in those areas are not important. So perhaps the main gap in the framework that the FSAP team found is about the legal framework for macroprudential policies, and they gave this recommendation that they need, that I'll say FI because I can't say the word properly. They need a clear legal mandate, and the emphasis is on addressing systemic risks in a timely and effective manner. Now, a few days after we sent the report to the board, there was a political agreement to deal with this issue. We understand at some point there will be legislation circulated on this, and hopefully will become effective in 2018. And that's very welcome. We'll be following that process. We have to follow up on all the recommendations in the FSAP over time, and we'll be following on this one particularly closely. I guess what we'll be thinking about is, does it satisfy that recommendation? You know, is it going to be timely and effective? I think it's still the question we want to discuss. And the second aspect of this was on the Financial Stability Council. Actually, the Financial Stability Council was adopted, I think it was 2013, I'm not sure, but I think it followed a previous FSAP recommendation from 2011. Now, there's a sense that the Financial Stability Council is not quite as effective as it could be. And we made some recommendations. Maybe the Financial Stability Council could make recommendations to the FI and even have a complier explain power. And we were told very firmly, nope, not possible under the Constitution. But so we continued to have the broad goal in mind that the FSC should somehow contribute more effectively to the fulfillment of the macroprudential mandate. And there's a forthcoming review of the FSC, and that's, we encourage that review take that idea into account. Now, related to the mandate of the FI, we have the Riksbank, and Parliament is reviewing the Riksbank law. We have a couple of related recommendations on clarifying its mandate in financial stability. One is liquidity support, just providing a clear authority for that for financial stability purposes. And the other is systemic financial risks. Already the Riksbank is putting out its financial stability reports. We suggest that this should be just underpinned by law, without implying that this is some exclusive monopoly privilege. Certainly, financial stability analysis is something that benefits from a range of perspectives and analytical approaches. So it's really just clarifying the Riksbank's responsibilities without limiting other contributions. For a number of reviews, the FSAP teams have urged that the resources of FI be strengthened, and we do it again this time. So why do we keep on repeating this? Well, it's kind of obvious that FI supervises the largest banks in this region. And if you look at the numbers of staff, it's quite modest relative to the scale of the sector. And it's not that every country has to converge to the same average, but there is a certain expectation for a systemic country to be very much on top of things and to be heavily involved these days in oversight. So we welcome that was an increase in resources in the last budget, and we suggest to review again at the next budget, especially because the branchification of Nordea could just add to those responsibilities that FI has. Usually we would start with the stress tests. In Sweden's case, it was maybe less exciting than elsewhere. We did try to design a very severe distress. You know, we have a global slump in activity, a 6 percentage point rise in unemployment, a 30% fall in house prices. I could mention that my colleague and I looked very closely at the experience of Denmark in designing this scenario. And what happened? Well, there were some credit provisions in the corporate sector. There were some income losses owing to higher funding costs. But no banks fell below the regulatory threshold. So overall, it came out quite resilient. But then probably the most interesting aspect was in this bottom right chart, you see essentially the same stress, but widely different results. And it just tells you that with a country has a long period with a high degree of stability and not too many non-performing loans, it's quite hard to figure out what the impact of stress will be. And on that basis, we came to this recommendation to have a leverage ratio as a backstop. We're not denying that there's actually very good work in dealing with these model issues in terms of the minimum risk weights on mortgages and the new approach on corporate loans. Foreign currency liquidity. This is probably one of the most challenging parts of the work. We thought we really have to try and dig deeply into this issue because it's so big in Sweden, the foreign currency funding. And banks have improved their liquidity since the crisis. And it's in part because Sweden has actually gone beyond international norms and actually apply the liquidity coverage ratio at the currency level for dollars and euro. When we did the analysis, if you go beyond a one-month horizon to like a three-month horizon, even given the stronger than standard regulations, you can get quite large needs for liquidity support. But it all depends very much on what you assume. So let me show you two versions. One, maybe conservative or prudent scenario, you can get needs of about 40-something billion dollars over a three-month horizon. An alternative scenario where you allow the banks to draw down their own liquidity a good deal more, you can reduce that to about 25 or 30 billion. I think whatever way you look at it, these are big numbers. And it calls into question that maybe there's still a need to tighten up those foreign exchange liquidity requirements. But we didn't make a firm recommendation. We suggest to evaluate that. One idea is to monitor LCR over a three-month horizon. Another idea is that the high-quality liquid assets the banks hold could actually be even higher quality, because some of them have a high credit quality but are not particularly liquid on the market in a crisis period, maybe like covered bonds. If you held more sovereign paper and fewer covered bonds, it's more likely you can liquidate your own assets without using them as collateral at the central bank. So in these circumstances, we don't say reserves need to be increased. We call for caution on reducing them. And the last point, it just reflects back to this interconnectedness of the system, and there's some factoids at the start. I mean, the region is very much aware of that interconnectedness. One example is the Nordic-Baltic Macroprudential Forum. It's very good that the region is working on some new memoranda of understanding. We're very keen to see them when they come out, not before. We're hoping they set a really good standard for other regions in terms of the coordination of supervision, coordination of liquidity, coordination of resolution, because financial stability in the region really depends on achieving a good outcome on this work. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much. Jesper, please.
Okay. Thanks a lot for having me here. All right. This is a very good. These are very good reports. So it's not an easy job that I have. I've read the reports, and they're good. They are well documented. There are a lot of analytics, and they are balanced. So they are good reports. But what I was going to do is, I'm going to give a very, very brief summary, because Greg just gave a nice presentation of what's in there, just very briefly. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to make some comments to some of the conclusions in the report. And then the final point, I'm going to say a little bit about some lessons that, at least in Denmark, we drew from the crisis and that perhaps can be relevant for Sweden. So very briefly, on the left-hand columns, I have the conclusions in the report, and the right-hand, I have at least some of the, probably the most important of the recommendations. Sweden is enjoying robust growth, economic growth, and that's good. It's coming down from probably a too high level. Inflation is coming up to target. Monetary and fiscal policies, they are expansionary. Fiscal policy, modestly expansionary. Monetary policy, quite expansionary. Household debt is increasing, particularly for new mortgages. There's a system of large, complex, and interconnected banks. The banks are robust, the report concludes, And then it concludes that immigration presents a labor market challenge. Then the recommendations is that monetary policy should remain expansionary and fiscal policy slightly expansionary. And as Craig also said, there's even room for more expansionary monetary policy. Then IMF recommends to phase out interest rate deductibility. And notice here, it doesn't say only reduce. It says phase out. That means reduce down to zero. Then it recommends a cap on debt-to-income ratios, stepping up supervisory authorities or activity. And to do that, the FA, the Financial Supervision, needs additional funding. Evaluate FX liquidity requirements. Again, notice here, it says evaluate, exactly as Craig also emphasized. They don't necessarily recommend, but they recommend to evaluate. Then assuming leverage ratios are introduced, there should be a clearer mandate for FI and Riksbanken, and then migrants should be integrated into the workforce. That's going to be a challenge going forward, the report says. Okay, and I agree on most of this, basically. But nevertheless, I am in the role of a discussion, so I have to discuss. So I'm going to make now three comments on the report and some of the conclusions. And I think the first comment here is that the report is concerned, I think it's fair to say, about the increase in household debt and house prices, because the house price increase in house prices is what leads to the increase in household debt. And it recommends a range of different options, as was just mentioned. I think one could have said a little bit more about what I show in this graph, surprisingly, at least to me, clear relation between interest rates and changes in house prices. So what you have on the left-hand scale is the repo rate inverted. So this is now 20-9. So it's a little bit early for this, but it's inverted. So it starts positively and going down going up to negatively. So the repo rate was 0.25 in 2010, increased to around 2% in 11, and then now it's minus 0.5. And then on the right-hand graph, I have the year-on-year growth in real house prices. And as a presenter, you often look for nice graphs to illustrate things. When I made this graph, I was simply struck how close the relationship is since the crisis. So what this indicates is that when the central bank is lowering interest rates, it's not strange that the agents in the economy, the households and firms, they're responding to that, and they're responding to that by taking up debt. So as long as the central bank is lowering interest rates, it probably will be difficult to really bring down house price changes. And what we've seen is when they keep them flat, the interest rate, then house price changes, they come down a little bit. Of course, it's very difficult to use the interest rate to really influence house prices because the interest rate influences all prices in the economy. But I still think that this should be should be noticed. My second comment is this, and this is probably not a real comment on the report. It's probably more a comment to the Swedish discussion in general. And the comment is this, that when I look at the figures for Sweden, I don't think that overall household debt is particularly high. And it hasn't been growing by particularly much. So what I do in this graph is I show the change in Swedish household debt to income and then an average of those 16 OECD countries for which I could find data 20 years back. And then I also show Denmark, the country I come from. So if you're a little bit worried about household debt to income, then how do you think we feel on the other side of Öresund? So the main point here is that, yes, household debt certainly has been increasing from around 90% of disposable income in 95 to today, 170-180%. But it so has it in all other countries, basically, at least these 16 developed countries. And that is perhaps a problem and a thing for concern and so on, but Sweden is not very different on this from all other countries. Why is debt increasing again? Yeah, interest rates are low. So we have a period where interest rates are coming down. How do agents respond? You have a relative prices change in the economy, and this is a relative price of taking up debt. Yeah, then people take up more debt. So at least that's one thing. And it's easier to service debt, of course, when interest rates are also low. What I very much agree upon with IMF is that the very strong increase of highly indebted new borrowers, that's a cause for concern, but not necessarily Sweden is standing out on overall debt. Okay. Then I've seen my third comment, and this is third comment is this. This is probably to the panel that's going. I've seen the invitation to this this meeting today, and it says in the one of the questions that the panel is going to discuss is whether Sweden has the best banks in the world. And that is perhaps true. I don't know. But what I can tell you is that Sweden is at least the best country, or the Swedish banks are the best banks in the Nordic countries to reduce risk weights. So what I show on the left-hand graph is this is from a bank analytic from the SEB in Denmark. So what I show on the left-hand graph, I show some Danish banks, Danske Bank, Swedbank, Jysbank, and then I show one Norwegian bank, DNB, and then I show the big four Swedish banks. And it's, of course, difficult for you to see because it's a little bit far away and so on. But what I can tell you basically is that what you have down here is the Swedish banks, and what that basically means is that since 2007, risk weights, they have been more or less cut in half. And to a much larger degree than what you see in particular what you see in Denmark. What you then see on the right-hand graph is that's the increase in CET1, so core equity ratios, for, again, the same banks. And then I split it up, or the bank analytics split it up, and I think it's so nice, so I copy it. I split it up in how much this increase in capital ratios actually comes from capital, so that's the so light blue columns, and how much comes from models, we can call it, meaning changing risk weights. And then on the right-hand graph, you see what's the fraction of the increase in capital ratios that comes from models. And again, you have the four Swedish bank in the middle, and that's where this line, it peaks, and around 80% of the increase in capital ratios, at least from 2007 to 14, comes from changing in models, comes from changes in risk weights. And then you can think, of course, there are two reasons why risk weights can come down. One is that banks, they lend out less risky. And it's absolutely fine that risk weights are coming down because this is a less risky portfolio. But then you can ask the question, why is it that risk weights are coming down if it's for the right reasons, so to say? And that is if you have had a long period where asset prices are increasing, house prices are increasing, and there are no losses, then risk weights will come down. But when you have such a long period, is that then a period where there's actually less risk? Good question. So these are the three comments I would make. So the recommendation then, somehow slightly based on this, is a leverage ratio of the IMF. I'm not a fan of leverage ratios, even though I've showing you this graph. I'm not a fan of leverage ratio. I'm more a fan of some of the other things that the FI actually has done with lower weights on mortgage exposures and so on. So these are my three comments to the reports: interest rates and debt. How high is debt actually in Sweden, and then risk weights in banks. Let me turn to some of the things that we learned in my country, so to say, or in Denmark. I chaired, I don't think, was it mentioned at the beginning? I don't know if it was mentioned. Then I mentioned. I chaired a government-appointed committee in Denmark that was set down right after, or in 2012, a couple of years ago, after the crisis. And we were a big group analyzing the financial crisis in Denmark. There were also representatives from the central bank and the ministries and the FSA and so on. So somehow it was, so to say, the official storytelling about the financial crisis in Denmark. We made a couple of conclusions and a lot of nice, at least I think, nice studies. And one of the things that happened in Denmark, that was that we have a big bank. Perhaps in this country you're a little bit concerned about the size of Nordea, perhaps not. It's around 150% of GDP when they get the branches, as far as I think, something like that. In Denmark, we have Danske Bank. It's 2 times GDP. So again, we beat you on that one. That's a big bank, and it's important for the Danish economy, of course. What we conclude in this committee was that there's no doubt that this very big bank had put itself in a vulnerable position, which, given the size of a bank, could shake Denmark's financial stability if risks did materialize. What were these risks? One of the risks was that this is a global bank, this is a large bank, and they operate like other large banks, meaning they have a significant fraction of their funding is wholesale funding. A significant fraction of that wholesale funding was in dollars. What happened in autumn 2008, as you probably all know, is that the dollar market basically froze down. It was basically impossible for non-US banks to raise dollars, and it was even difficult for U.S. banks, of course, to borrow, but in particular for non-U.S. banks, it was very difficult to raise U.S. dollars. And then we say in the report, and I actually was here a couple of years ago, not in this room, but in another SNS room, and presenting the report, and then back then I mentioned the sentence that I have down there is probably the most dramatic sentence that I have ever written. And I've written lots of sentences, I can tell you. And it said, this sentence said that if things had turned out differently, meaning even worse than they did in autumn 2006, it could have reduced the foreign currency reserves of Denmark even further, and in the worst case scenario, have been a threat to the fixed exchange rate policy or the government's possibility of fulfilling its obligations. That means there was a serious risk of Denmark not fulfilling its obligations. And again, this is not just an academic report. There were actually representatives from the central bank and so on. So this is some sense official storytelling. So what this tells us that a lack of dollar liquidity in banks certainly can be very critical. Okay. Next thing is, so in the FSAP from IMF, it says, so this is the quotation from the report of Swedish banks, it says, stress tests suggest that banks and non-banks are largely resilient to solvency shocks, but concerns persist about the ability of bank models to capture unexpected losses, and Craig has explained that that is, and I agree very much. I just want to make a reflection on that, and how much, in some sense, can you trust stress tests? I mean, I don't want to sound so, you know, too critical. Of course we should make stress tests, and of course we should do them as good as we can, etc., etc. But stress tests are only as good as they are, and sometimes stresses appear in unexpected places. In Denmark, the central bank also does a financial stability report 2 times a year, in January and in June. And this is directly copy-pasted. So it's directly open the PDF file, copy-paste, from the very first page of one of the financial stability reports. So it's really the first thing it says when you open that financial stability report. It says, robust financial sector in Denmark. When do you think that financial stability report was made? June 2008. 4 months after the Danish economy and the Danish sovereign was almost about to not to be able to fulfill its promises due to the banks. Again, we have all learned from stress tests and we're doing them better today and so on, and we should do them, etc. I'm just saying that stress tests, we should not, exactly as was emphasized by Craig, we should take care of interpreting them in the right way. Then, third lesson, house price bubbles, they can be incredibly costly. I don't think there's any doubt on that in this room, so this is just an illustration of that, so to say. So this is a house price bubble in Denmark, and if you sometimes, again, you look for good graphs to illustrate a bubble, here you are. This is probably the perfect illustration of a bubble, a house price bubble in this case. And what you see is the impact on the real economy. So what you see is when house prices are increasing a lot in Denmark, employment was increasing by around 150,000 people. That's so 6, 7, 8% of employment. When the house price bubble burst, we lost around 100,000 jobs. And then when house prices have now, throughout the last couple of years, been rising again, yeah, then we have seen again an increase in jobs. Of course, it's very difficult to say causality here. Is it the good economy that leads to house prices, or is it the house price that leads to the economy, and so on? But there's a very clear relation. How does it look in Sweden? Yeah, now I put Sweden, and then you should notice that the left-hand graphs, it goes up, whoops, because I want to have Swedish house prices here. And the Swedish house prices over the same period, and what has happened to Swedish employment during this period, it has been a good economy, so the Swedish employment has increased by around 600,000, which I also think is so close to 10%. Okay. What's going to happen to house prices after this? So what's going to happen to Swedish house prices after this? I don't know. Why don't I know? I don't know because it's difficult to forecast house prices. So what I show on the left-hand graph is again a picture from this report. So I look at an independent agency here. So this is an independent forecaster. So this is we have a Danish Economic Council, Vice Economists, or whatever it's called. So an independent council, Økonomisk Råd, som det hedder, in Denmark. And you see the green line, so to say, that's what I showed you on the previous slide, that's the bubble. And then you saw, see their forecasts in 2004, and they predicted basically flat house prices. Then you see in 2005, slightly increasing. They are exploding. Then they're saying they're going to go up a little bit, then they're flat. Then they expect them to be flat. Then they're coming down like crazy. Or then they update their forecast and expect them to come down like crazy. And then they stay flat. It's very difficult to forecast, in particular, large changes in house prices. So what's going to happen out here? Incredibly important question. Very difficult to say. I have here increases in house prices with 5%, as has been the case since 2000. Flat, fall, I don't know. But it's, of course, it's important. Okay. Then one of the things that I know that you discuss in this country is whether you should reduce or phase out interest rate deductibility. We in Denmark, we have lowered, we have not phased out, but we have lowered interest rate deductibility quite significantly. That's on the left-hand graph. So the interest rate deductibility, the rate of interest rate deductibility, and it's coming down a lot. And then why do you also discuss that in this country? That's also because you're worried about house prices and house price bubbles, etc., and debt, of course. And then I've just showed you that in spite of this fact that we have reduced interest rate deductibility a lot, we had a house price bubble. So the fact that you are reducing interest rate deductibility, it probably helps, but it will not necessarily eliminate, so to say, the risk of a house price bubble. So the debate on interest rate deductibility is it's not very hot in Denmark. We don't think it's a hot topic. And that is the one reason is we think it will come down pretty much. And the other is this economic argument or political argument that lowering interest rate deductibility, so to say, hurts often the younger more than the elder, so to say, in the sense that younger people, they are those that have to borrow a lot. So there are also these issues in this. What have we done in Denmark in order to, and this is my this is my second last slide, so I'll conclude after this one. So what are we also now actually, because we have had this house price bubble and we have seen house prices throughout the last couple of years in Denmark starting increasing again, so we are starting getting a little bit worried again in Denmark. We're not discussing interest rate deductibility a lot. We are discussing house taxes instead. But then we're also doing some macroprudential regulation. So we now have a, beforehand, there was no, before 2015, there was no requirement of any down payment. You could borrow 100% to finance your house. You have 15% here, so it's more. But there was no requirement in Denmark, so a down payment requirement was introduced. 5%, little, yes, but it was introduced. Then we are concerned also about the variable rates, the fraction of borrowers with variable rates in Denmark. So we're shocking them with an interest rate increase when they take up a new loan. So in order for a borrower to get a variable rate loan, he should be able, or she should be able to finance a fixed rate mortgage over 30 years of 4%. So interest rates in Denmark, they're negative. So we're shocking them more or less with 4 percentage points. And then we also have, wealth to indicators based on that wealth should be positive when debt to income ratios they are high. So that's the way we do it in Denmark. So if debt, that's what the last point. So if debt to income ratio is high, 4 to 5%, and then if house prices they fall with 10%, yeah, then wealth should be positive. And if it's more than 5, then wealth should be positive if house prices fall by 25%. So we have started introducing some of these macroprudential tools. So I'll conclude. And I'll first conclude with say, you know, keep calm. We should not exaggerate anything and so on. But we should, of course, also be prepared. We should be aware of the risks out there. And there's just no doubt in my mind. Of course, one day house prices will come down. In all countries, at some point, house prices will come down. And Sweden is in a situation where there is a risk that house prices will come down. Compared to Denmark, Sweden is better prepared, I would say. So Sweden has introduced a lot of things, and this is a copy from the IMF report where you can see all of the things that Sweden has already done, increased counter-cyclical buffers, etc., etc. So Sweden has already done a lot. But if I should emphasize one thing that I do think Sweden should do, then I'm very much in agreement with IMF that it should be some kind of debt-to-income, debt-service-to-income, debt-to-wealth. Some of these ratios would be sensible to introduce, would be my recommendation. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much. Before we continue with the panel, we've agreed that 10 minutes of coffee and fresh air might be a good idea. So if you are back in 10 minutes, we will continue then. Welcome back. Hope you enjoyed the coffee and the fresh air. Now we have our panel on stage. Erik Tidén, Director General, is the term in English, isn't it, for Finansinspektionen. Anna Breman, Chief Economist at Swedbank. Hans Lindberg, CEO of Swedish Bankers Association. And Peter Englund, Professor at the Stockholm School of Economics. And I thought we'd do it like this. I'll give them the opportunity, panel the opportunity, to comment on what we heard before the break. Whatever comment you sort of feel like making. And after that, we open up for the floor. There are lots of people in the audience with lots of knowledge and views on what we've heard about. And sort of, it would be great to hear what you think. You can ask questions to our two introducers and to the panel, and we can have a debate on these topics. So, Erik, please.
Okay, thank you very much, and thank you for a very good presentation from both of you. I think there was enlightening. Of course, I've read the IMF report, and me and especially my staff struggled with the FSAP, so we're very glad it's only every 5 years, and not only every year, because that is definitely a struggle, but we learned a lot. A few comments. When it comes to kind of the macroprudential framework, I think my take is that this is very much a learning process globally. So when we look out internationally, I think you did some work on that as well. It's very, very hard to find a model. So sometimes you hear the debate in Sweden that we are so strange because we haven't sorted out this with macroprudential. Well, every country is strange. So if I go to my US colleagues, or for that matter, my French colleagues, and I say, we have this great idea that we actually have the legal right to propose amortizations, and that could be decided directly after by the government, they will say, okay, we could never have that. Because that, you know, so even sometimes we argue that we are weak, some of our tools are actually much stronger than would be possible in many other countries. So having said that, it's just to kind of make the case that this is very much in a learning process. And I think commenting a little bit on the proposal made by the government, I think it's a big step forward. Of course, it will take some time because there will be a kind of a process to get the legislation in order in 2018. But that's how democracies work. But the idea that we have now a political support for a broad mandate for the FI, not a mandate like they have in the UK, where they actually take a decision issue by issue or tool by tool, if you like. So they have a DTI, they took a decision on a DTI, and if they want something more, they need to go to the government, to the parliament again. This would be a broad mandate. So that's good. It also gives us a very, very strong position because we basically have the right to look into and propose a specific proposals. And then the yes or no is made by the government. It's not the parliament. And this, there is a risk for an inaction bias. I take that argument made by, I think, IMF kind of hinted that, and I think that's been the case that's been made by some other commentators as well. But we have this process when it comes to amortization, worked fine. We have the process actually in the debt policy area, where the debt office proposes kind of the duration and so on for debt, and it's basically yes or no for the government. And that's been worked well for a number of years. So it's not a totally kind of strange animal. That's when it comes to the macro prudential. And when it comes to you know, the specific tools, I typically agree with what's been said. I think the next step is a DTI. We don't have the legal mandate as we speak now. I also made a case, I think it's important to say, I think that was made good by Jesper, that of course the headwinds, if you like, are very, very strong. I think the combination of such a high growth and basically an economy with normal resource utilization, even above that, and minus rates, is a very, very kind of strange policy mix. There are good arguments why we are in this position, but it's uncharted territory. And that causes for some, you know, caution. And one way to handle that is, of course, to introduce more measures from our side. But I also think that measures from other policy areas is relevant. Tax deductibility was mentioned. I also think the whole kind of capital gain taxation and the kind of system around that is relevant to look into. And then I also made the case that there need to be some kind of broad discussion about the monetary policy role in this. And I listened to Craig and Jesper, you have totally different views on this. So I think it seems like Jesper is a little bit closer to me, saying that there might be something that you need to think into. It's very hard to come up with the right answers, but I got some questions yesterday and said, what? Yes, go to Australia or, for that matter, to Canada, and you find central bank that, to some extent anyway, take into account the kind of the balance sheet aspects, if you like, of monetary policy. Whereas it seems like IMF is all in for the inflation target, even in this kind of environment with strong headwinds. Also, when it comes to inflation, difficult questions. We need to have a discussion about it, and I welcome that we have it today. So that's my brief comments.
Thank you, Anna.
Well, I'd like to first thank you both. Excellent presentations. I very much appreciate that the IMF did bring up the fundamentals. So the fundamentals is very much that we have a dysfunctional housing market. And Professor Rangvid, you said that it's very difficult to make house price forecasts, and it is. But one forecast that is not very difficult to make, that's a population forecast. It's actually one of the easier. And if you look at... This is important in terms of debt. The next 7 years, Sweden will grow with 1 million people in 7 years. We're only 10 million at present, so growing with 1 million in 7 years is unprecedented. And in this environment, where you have a shortage of housing in about 250 out of 219 municipalities, I can't quite see how we can come to terms with that shortage without seeing further increases in debt levels. So there are two things driving debt levels in Sweden right now. It's, of course, higher house prices, and I'm not saying that there are no concerns regarding this. House prices have increased a lot. But the other thing is that we have moved from a reasonable rental market into mainly building owner-occupied housing. And if this continues, house debt levels will have to increase just because the stock increases that much. So when we're looking at what are the potential best options to mitigate the risk with high household debt, we'd have to look at the distribution of household debt. It's not evenly distributed if you look at regions, if you look at income groups, and it's not evenly distributed at all if you look at generational aspects. So when you look at different potential policy measures, I'm very much in favor of focusing on the supply side rather than the demand side. And I'm not saying that there's no scope for doing things on the demand side, but like interest rate deductibility, DTI I'm very much more skeptical of, because the banks already have their DTIs, the debt-to-income ratios, we do. But there is a range of measures that could be due to improve the supply side, both in terms of finding a proper rental market, both for those who have high incomes, but also for affordable housing for those who will have lower incomes. So I would really like to have the discussion focused on just the impact on the whole Swedish economy of the shortage of housing, taking into consideration that, of course, there are some risks in terms of household debt. But we have to look at the bigger picture, how it's affecting the labor market for companies to find the right type of skills in their companies, how to integrate newly arrived people into Sweden. It's very difficult when you can't move within the country because there's no housing. And the IMF, I know we're not discussing that section, but the section on integration that the IMF wrote was really excellent. So I just like to steer the discussion towards also thinking about the supply side. Thank you.
The IMF reports do stress supply sides,
yes,
of housing as well. So you agree on that?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, Hans.
Thank you so much. First, I would like to say that on a general level, I agree with many of the IMF's recommendations. But I have three issues I would like to elaborate on a little bit. First, I think it's important to state that further regulations, for instance, higher capital regulations, also comes with a cost. We all always talk about the benefits, but there are also costs. And Eric talked a little bit about this new mandate for the FSA. I personally welcome this broad political agreement to strengthen the mandate for the FSA on macroprudential measures. However, I think it's very important that the mandate is well-defined and focused on financial stability. Hence, the mandate should not be so wide that the FSA could involve in fine-tuning the business cycle. As IMF, FSB, and BIS has noted, macroprudential policy can easily be overburdened with objectives that is not really suited for. Finally, a last comment on household indebtedness. I think it's worth underscore that the credit behavior of banks has had very minor effects on the house price increase, and this is often overlooked in the public discussion. I believe that the house price increase has been driven by fundamental factors, as a too regulated housing market, the urbanization, and of course, as Jesper pointed out, the repo rate decrease since 2012. And I think that implies, if you look at on the economy at this stage, that the repo rate, the low negative repo rate, is actually the biggest financial risk in the economy. It influences households' debt, but also all asset markets. Thank you.
Peter.
Thank you. So I'd like to comment on two issues. One, which is in the report, but that Craig did not mention, as an issue that I strongly support. One which Craig did talk a bit about, where I disagree. So let's start with the thing I support. That's in fact a data issue. So do we know how serious the debt problem is? Well, that depends on what we think of household reactions. Should they be put under stress? And we can measure debt to income ratios. We can measure debt-to-debt service ratios, debt service to income ratios, but it also depends on the ratio of debt to assets. And we know in the aggregate that that has, if anything, gone down. We know that the total assets, the financial liquid financial assets of households are at about the same level as household debt. So households could, under stress, easily sell some assets, and that ratio has been quite constant. But of course, looking at the aggregate is too simplistic. It depends on the distribution of assets. And there we simply don't know anything. And why don't we know anything? Because that statistic used to exist until 2007, but then the wealth tax was abolished, and hence the statistics also were gone, even though the basic data are there. And I think, honestly, it's an outrage that we don't get that those numbers that do exist in the banks, that do exist at the Värdepapperscentralen, that they are not made available for analysis. And the report mentions that, but I wanted to applaud that and also to advertise it. So that's point number one. The thing where I disagree is about the tax system and interest deductibility, or at least I'm a bit skeptic about the conclusion. So if you're worried about debt and see that it's increasing, it's natural to think about the price of borrowing. Well, that depends on the interest rate after tax. the interest rate before taxes is monetary policy. We can't do much about that. So it's natural, I think, that the debate has come to focus on interest deductibility. But I think that's a bit misguided, or at least it's too partial. I think this is a broader tax issue where you should think about the overall system of capital taxation. And I think it's problematic if you adjusting the tax system year by year for financial stability reasons. So I think you need to take a longer term perspective. And of course, there are arguments perhaps that debt is inherently problematic because it's tied to stability problems. So just like we have environmental taxes, perhaps we should punish borrowing by the tax system. There may be some merit to that argument, but I think there's also merit to the counter-argument that borrowing is needed in order for households, for young households, to get into the housing market. So there's a sort of distributional argument that goes the other way. So then I think it's natural to think of this in sort of a boring neutrality perspective. And then you could argue that today the tax system, at current low interest rates, the overall tax system is reasonably neutral. The rate of taxation of financial assets that you put into this account, investeringssparkonto, is at about the same level as the value of deductibility of interest payments, and about the same level as the total taxation of real estate, of owner-occupied housing, if you add the capital gains taxes. So somewhat surprisingly, when you think about it, the system seems reasonably neutral today. But that is today. So think of a situation with more normal interest rates. Then the investeringssparkonto, the tax will go up, so we will maintain some form of neutrality relative to interest deductibility. But then it's really property taxation that stands out. So I think the discussion shouldn't focus on interest deductibility. It should focus on getting back a proper property tax. Thanks.
Thank you. I think maybe we should spend some minutes on this issue. Jesper argued a bit like Peter did, as I heard it. But in the debate, many in Sweden seem to believe that reducing interest rate deductibility is a sort of step towards a solution. And I would like to hear, like Craig or Eric or somebody, comment on these views.
But there is this neutrality argument, but both the capital gains tax part of it and the deductibility part of it is not perfect. So if you take the tax deductibility, if you have interest rates up to 100,000 a year, it's 30%. If you're above that, it's 21%. So we have lived with that unneutrality. And you mentioned in the Sweden's sparkonto, but there's of course other assets as well. You could think about the taxation on dividends or whatever. So this is a whole area, and I'm not an expert in it, but I think, and it's also very different between different individuals what kind of assets you have. So I think there's still some room. But I take your argument. The reason why I haven't talked about the property tax, it is to me very obvious that it lacks any political backing. So it could just be, it's just a theoretical discussion, in my view. And I'm very much, what could we do here and now? To be very honest, I don't think it's politically possible in the foreseeable future, but I think it's politically possible to do something when it comes to capital gains taxes and tax deductibility. But I definitely take your argument. And also a quick comment on the supply side. I agree, but maybe interested to hear Jesper's comment. I think part of the Danish problem was that there was too much supply. So I'm starting actually to worry that maybe the whole kind of environment might, where everyone that stands on this kind of podium say we should build more. And then one wonder whether all of these building blocks that you see around Stockholm is actually a good thing if prices would drop by 30 or 40%. Maybe then some of them will not kind of be hard to find tenants, because of course refugees could not buy in this fancy house by the sea around Stockholm. So I think it's not that easy to say just supply. And the final point is that of course the structural arguments for debt that you take you mentioned, I think is well taken. So when we look on the debt increase to 2010, about 25% was for structural reasons. And we have pronounced that and said that, and of course that should be kind of deducted in a way, right? Because that is not a real problem if people buy their houses and so on, and if you have a lot of new buildings. But 75% is not structural.
Hans asked for the word first. And Anna, you wanted to.
Yeah. Overall, I think Peter has right about saying that with these low interest rates, we have about a neutral tax system, actually, concerning the interest rate deductibility. And also, when the interest rates increase, you can keep that neutrality by adjusting the property tax and the cutting point between 21 and 30 percentage points deductibility. If we would take away the deductibility completely, we would increase the marginal and the average income tax rate a lot. So in that case, we had to make adjustment in the overall tax system, I believe.
Mm. Anna.
Okay, where to start? Property taxes. I know that it seems to be politically very difficult in the current environment, but I think that if you look at how low property taxation is in Sweden today in an international perspective, it's quite remarkable. And I think that if you actually introduce a little bit higher caps on property taxes, at the same time as you, for example, lower marginal tax rates, that would be economically a very wise move to do. And I don't think it would be completely impossible to get that through if there is a debate in Sweden regarding that issue. Because the property tax would also incentivize mobility that's been very low in the Swedish housing market. And it has a good distributional aspect to it. On the interest rates deductibility, I don't agree with the IMF of phasing it out entirely. I could see potentially lowering the cap somewhat, but I don't think it's the best way forward right now. I think I stopped. No, I want to make one more comment regarding the low interest rates. First of all, everyone is assuming that interest rates would just go up. We can't take that for certain. It's been a structural decline in real interest rates over the past 30 years. And there are underlying structural reasons for that. So we should maybe take into consideration, we look at the housing market, that interest rates will not go back to 6-7% is what the banks still stress households when they get a new mortgage. 6-7%. It's not 4% like in Denmark. Although I do see, obviously, a possibility that they will go up, but not to the same levels as before. The other thing is that low interest rates have increased household debt. I think that's reasonable. I mean, correlation is not obvious, but you can also see other things that happen at the same time. But savings, and that's what you were coming to, and if you look at the wealth position, I very much agree that it's time to get the wealth data, because we cannot follow on an individual level who has debt and who has assets. And assets are very high, and they've increased more than debt. The other thing is that if you just look at savings, It's when we went into the crisis in the 1990s, savings were negative. The savings ratio in Sweden today is 16%. Mm. Now, just if you look at savings into regular savings accounts, it's at 1,600 billion krona today. That's 160,000 per Swede sitting in regular savings accounts with no interest.
With zero interest, yeah.
Yeah, so it's not that there is no buffer in the household sector. It's really quite remarkable, despite negative interest rates.
Oh.
So, yeah.
Jesper, please.
Yeah, but just I got a direct question from Eric, then I think I should answer it.
Absolutely.
And the question was, so I don't know about the impediments to structural building in Sweden and so on, but of course if there are impediments there, it seems natural that they should be removed if they're structural. But the question I got was the construction in Denmark before the crisis, and it's what you're hinting at is exactly this, that what happened was that house prices were booming and there was quite a lot of building activity going on, and that building activity was, fair to say, what to a large extent led to a lot of the problems that we had in the Danish banks. So we had a crisis and many banks went bankrupt, and a lot of that was due to this, that they built a lot of houses and apartment blocks.
But that was more commercial real estate.
That was commercial real estate, but I think that's what you're hinting at.
But it was both commercial and housing, right?
It was particularly commercial. It was particularly commercial. Also, one thing from Denmark is that we have actually a housing taxation that to some extent follow house prices. And we are actually in Denmark, we're actually discussing that it should follow house prices even more. So it is possible in some countries to discuss it politically.
Okay, do we have somebody with a microphone? I have a question over there. And please raise your hand so I can have you on the speaker's list. Please.
Jörgen Andersson, Finansutskottet, ledamot där. The Swedish financial system is given relative to GDP very large. And for obvious reasons, we have been discussing the households' debts and also the bank sector. But is there a risk in itself that we are not seeing the forest because of the trees? Because given the low rate environment and also in some opinions very high asset levels, what about the insurance markets? In the report from IMF, they are raising some concerns about the Solvency II regulation not implemented in more than 40% of the insurance markets. Now, I know that FI has taken some actions to try and make some more same level protection for the whole market. Is that enough? And will there be a transitional period until 2019? Will it be enough until then? Thank you.
Who feels like I'm looking at Eric?
Yeah, well, I think the overall picture that we paint in the stability report is that the solvency levels are okay in the insurance sector, but we also say that it's been a fairly extreme situation. There has been sharp drop in interest rates, which boosts their assets, but especially it boosts the debt side of the balance sheet. So basically that worsened their solvency. But at the same time, we have been having booming equity markets. So that saved them in a way, right? Going forward, if you have zero interest rates, you can't expect 10-15% increase in equities every year. So the long term, the business model, you could say, is under threat. Then they are taking some actions. They are lowering their guaranteed rate and they are you know, investing in other assets. But I think, point taken, I think they are definitely in a kind of little bit of troublesome business environment. When it comes to occupational and insurance companies, we have this traffic light system where we have come up with a suggestion to strengthen that. And we are now in a kind of evaluation phase, how to impose or not impose that. And, you know, there are strong opinions around that as well. But the idea is, of course, to safeguard also the occupational pension companies in about the same way as Solvency II, although they don't have the same regulation. So we'll see exactly where we end up, and that will probably be decided in the next couple of months.
And the Swedish insurance system is a bit of an outlier in a European context, in the sense that if interest rates fall, they are more interest rate sensitive, so the value of their balance sheets decrease more than many. It's one of the sort of more exposed.
I think
because they have relatively short assets.
Correct, but even more important for the whole insurance system is that the interest rate, when it comes to the official solvency ratios, are rigged, and it's rigged by us, because basically, as I said, you could have an UFR. The UFR, it's ultimate forward rate. So basically we fix pure yeah. discounting rate.
Mm.
And that's fine if the you know, the world ends up at this kind of theoretical level, but that's at 4.2%.
And rates are so low below that.
So that's also a risk. So yeah. the solvency leverage that we look at is kind of rigged, but they're rigged by us, so don't blame the companies, it's as us. Okay.
Okay. Bob Lundgren and then Peter.
I had the responsibility for tax policy and financial markets in the beginning of the 90s in Sweden, which was rather fun in a way. but coming to the tax policy issues, I'm glad that some people do propose reintroducing a property tax, because that's the main problem we have today. We had a system before the tax reform in the 90s where we had a symmetric system. Tax deductibility, on the other hand, assessed value on property was up for taxation as a capital income. So there was a symmetric system. I warned when we had the reform that going to a pure property tax would delegitimize the tax, which it did, so it got off. When Eric and others say that it's not politically feasible to propose a property tax, well, if it's not politically feasible, you have to do the argument for it, and then suddenly it becomes politically feasible. If you accept that you cannot discuss it, then, of course, it won't be that you have it. There are distributional problems with taking away tax deductibility. I mean, if you're rich, you can buy something. There is no property tax whatsoever. If you need to borrow, it's not only young people versus old people like me. It's also a question about the one who have and the one who has not. So what we should do is to ask for a tax reform in reintroducing the old form of property taxation. And, of course, you should, as I tried to do, lower the rate from 30. We decided to go down to 25% capital income tax and then down to 20. That was reversed when we lost the election in 94. And you do lose elections when you manage financial crisis, of course. But anyway, so I think that both Eric and other ones should talk about reintroducing property tax, lowering step by step the rate for the taxation, and then we'll be rather fine in this respect. There are some other things to discuss as well, I suppose.
Thank you. Peter.
I just had a little comment on tax reform. Sometimes it's easier to do a reform if you yeah. if you do it more broadly. Sure. And sometimes it's easier if you relabel things. there is an
you have any idea?
Are you a politician?
Yes, there is an interest. I'd like to advertise an interesting proposal that Sven Lodin is discussing, namely the so-called box system, which is a sort of modified wealth taxation, if you wish, or an extension of the investeringssparkonto, where you add other assets into the box, like housing, and where you can add debt into the box and get a system which almost by definition is neutral. And I think that maybe that's another way of going forward on the one that Bo was suggesting.
Relabeling. More questions, comments? While you're thinking, I had one. I've warned the panel about this. When we plan these seminars and we ask people what topic would you be interested in, one of the most frequent answers is negative interest rates. There is something strange with negative interest rates. Sort of how long can a country have? If I lend money to somebody and we agree that they pay me because I lend them, and then the central bank said, no, it's supposed to be the other way around. They pay when people sort of, do you see any, the report touches upon the effects of banking, at least, of negative interest rates. But do you see sort of if we have a longer period, you say that the easy monetary policy could easily go on for some time. Does it create misallocations or sort of problems in the system to have a longer period of negative interest rates? Does anybody sort of dare to? I realize it's a difficult question, but it's something many people are thinking about. Anna?
I can always start on that one, working at the bank. No, but I think one thing that we haven't discussed is that if we have a very low interest rate environment and people have floating rate mortgages, we should maybe consider giving people incentives to fix their mortgages with a longer duration. Because if we have fluctuations and if interest rates start rising, then houses will be less sensitive. Because the main problem with the low interest rates and high debt currently is not the bank's portfolio. I mean, we've seen that. You can stress the banks in Sweden with almost anything, and there's not that much risk in the mortgage portfolio and the banks. But households might consume less if interest rates go up, so you get negative effects on other household sectors. So thinking about maybe giving better incentives to have fixed-rate mortgages with longer duration would be a way to reduce sensitivity. And the other thing that I was thinking about is actually I thought about that when I read the IMF report. One issue that's not addressed at all is low productivity in Sweden. Productivity, not in the past 1 or 2 years, but if you look at the 10 years, 95 to 05, we had 2.8% productivity growth per year. In the past 10 years, we've had 0.5. And one discussion that is out there is that if you have low interest rates, well, there might be less turnover in companies, less creative destruction. I don't have an answer to that, but I think the IMF should look into, you know, how is Swedish competitiveness really doing in terms of looking into low productivity, and could low interest rate be one of the reasons that we see very low productivity on the global scale, because we see it in most Western countries right now.
Eric?
I think when you look at our stability report, the low interest rate environment comes up as a risk in all different sectors. It comes up in insurance, as was mentioned. It comes up when it comes to kind of assets or markets, where this hunt for yield argument, I think, is a very valid one. And of course, it comes up when it comes to the risk in debt levels in household sector, and for that matter, going forward, maybe also in the corporate sector. So, the low interest rate environment is creating issues when it comes to stability. And I think especially now, when we've gone from a higher interest level to a low, maybe if you think low forever, maybe then the economy will adapt and everything is fine, and there are consensus that 1 or 2% long interest rate is fine. But now it's kind of very, very unsure whether this level is sustainable, and the risk is that people are trying to have adapted to that in a too fast way, if you like. So I think the whole issue, but that is not answer to your question whether negative interest rates is itself. That's becomes even more to sort of a technical issue and a philosophical one, which is good for a dinner conversation, but I don't have any really bright thing to say in this setting.
But the fact that they are negative per se doesn't add any sort of problems that you can see.
Because
most
transactions in financial markets are still made with zero or positive interest rate. Right? It's more a kind of a relation between the central bank and the banks, generally speaking. Okay. And then that seems to be working fine. So.
Okay. Could I ask Jesper Rangvid? Anna said that Sweden is an outlier in some respects. And one of them is that the household borrowing, when the households fund their houses, they have very short interest rate maturities on their loans, typically like 3 months, which is very short. Denmark has much longer. Just an open question, what is your comment on the sort of significance of this, and what would be needed if we wanted to have people choosing longer periods of interest rates?
Yeah,
fixed interest rates in
very briefly. So traditionally, as you're saying, Pierre, we have a tendency to finance real estate by borrowing for 30 years or 20 years. But then
with fixed rate.
With fixed rate.
Because it's
fixed rate.
30 years here as well, but it's a floating
with
rate.
Fixed rate. Then before the crisis, there was a change in the way Danes financed their house purchases. So they started borrowing variable rates. So we saw that more than 50% of borrowing was variable rates. We were concerned, we also in the committee I chair, but in general, the rating agencies, the authorities, and it's actually the banks themselves probably were concerned about this interest rate exposure. So therefore...
Why were you concerned?
Yeah, exactly as Anna was said, that there was this, you could say, a credit risk, if you want to call it like that. So when interest rates go up... Perhaps banks don't lose that much money, but what happens is that people really want to stay in their house. So what they do is they cut down on other kinds of consumption in order to actually be able to still pay their debt services and thereby staying in their house. So we see consumption being cut and we see GDP going down and on all the bad things associated with that. Then there was also a refinancing issue in the bank, so more from a banking stability. But there were these two kind of issues. So therefore, the regulator, the FSA, started regulating the amount of variable rate loans that Danish mortgage institution can issue and can finance houses with. And therefore, we have seen now a change again. So what I'm saying here is I don't think the banks themselves, at least I think it's very difficult for banks themselves to cut down on variable rate loans, because what often happens is that banks, they compete. So if a customer cannot get a variable rate over in that bank, but he can't get it over in that bank, and then he probably goes to the bank that actually offers that. So I think there's a role for a regulator here if it's actually a concern, that somehow one could think about ways to regulate that issue. At least that's what we have done in Denmark, and it seems that it has worked.
Okay, Peter, while Eric thinks about if he wants to regulate the...
The obvious way to give households incentives to take longer maturities is to have loans with some form of prepayment option, or at least more generous rules with regard to prepayment. Because in the current system, one reason for taking very short term loans is that you don't know when you're moving. It's not just speculating about changes in interest rates. It's just having the opportunity to pay off the loan at any time that happens to suit you. So I think I don't have a solution exactly how that should be introduced, but I think it's worth thinking about. It's worth considering why we differ from some other countries in that respect.
No, I think I've seen a little bit of the Danish system. First, fair to say that very different traditions in different countries. So you had this kind of fixed rate tradition, and I think UK had a little bit the same, and we have it. So it comes with different systems. But then you come down to, you know, how to rig that, and I think Peter is pointing out as a good argument that if you regulate that, you basically lock in people, and that's, you know, that goes in the other direction. Maybe you get kind of more complicated housing market. I think when we look into this, because this is on a list of macroprudential issues, so of course we are looking into it. When we're thinking of it, you're thinking more of a kind of as a consumer protection issue. So is there any way that banks, you know, more could actually have this in a dialogue with the clients, and, you know, nudging or whatever, you know, try to put this up on the table when you discuss your mortgage and not only go for the lowest rate. So... Yes, for the record, I have part of my mortgage fixed. So.
Please.
My name is Jacob Bursell. I suppose you can say I work with a podcast. If this question is off topic, I beg you to ignore it. But it would be interesting to hear how resilient the Swedish financial system is to a crisis of confidence in the Eurozone, perhaps as a consequence of populists coming to power in Italy, for instance?
That's a good question. I mean, we talked about internally generated risks, but there are a lot of risks around us, and which of these are of most importance? Does anybody feel like...
No, I think it's a very good question. That's why we should have resilient banks, because we don't know what kind of the next crisis would be. I think you're pointing out a very relevant one. You know, when we go down in different meetings in Europe, we come out as a little bit the odd guy, because we have a strong economy with strong banks, with profitable banks, whereas in Italy, for example, they have, you know, weak banks, a weak economy. So, of course, if that would, you know, turn out to be more of a wide Eurozone crisis, that will definitely be bad for Swedish economy and Swedish banks. So the whole argument of resilience, I think, is, you know, Brexit or Trump. So we don't really try to, you know, what exactly would be the next crisis, but rather to think of resilience and hence capital requirements, liquidity ratios, or what. So I think it's relevant, and we should, you know, look at, you know, that risk. But I think we also have a strong position to start with, although there are some risks.
Does anyone else?
Just point out that the resilience is very high, even in terms of crisis. If you compare the Swedish banks and the amount of capital, the low risks on the portfolios, I'm not saying that a euro-wide new financial crisis wouldn't hit Sweden, but the banks are in a very good position to handle it right now.
Thank you.
Perhaps you could say some words about the Stability Board. I know there was a discussion in the IMF report, and that is for Erik Thedéen mostly.
Yeah, there were. I think we were one of the organizations that argued strongly against the idea to have this complier explained, because basically this is constitutionally very, very hard to have that the ministers as a chairman should ask his authority to do something. That goes against kind of our constitutional setup. Having said that, I'm not against to have a better discussion, more of concrete suggestions coming up in the board. But I think the idea to have a good discussion that is put into a protocol that is influencing the debate and hence influencing also the decision makers such as myself. That is the idea, and that's actually a very good idea. So I think it's a little bit, I think you should take that is the idea, and I think that's also something that works pretty well. And then we have, I think, a lot of complier explained. The Riksbank puts out a very, very good stability report with recommendations. We have a stability report. We make arguments. As Sweden, this is the whole, I would say, culture in Sweden, that we actually have a very open debate, even between public authorities, about the right policy measures. So would that be extremely much better to have a complier explaining it? I'm not sure. So I think it's new. It's going in the right direction, and I think we should evaluate it as we go along. But it's an okay start.
Thank you. Microphone. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm a freelance journalist, but I'd like to ask a practical question, maybe, because every day in my email I see many, many emails about, do you like to have loans, and so can people trust this kind of thing? I feel it implies maybe, indeed, it's like what Anna said, there is a surplus of money in the society, maybe. So can we trust this kind of internet loan?
That's for you, right?
That's famous last words if you say you should trust them, right? But of course, there are different players in this market. Some you probably could trust, but somebody we should be more doubtful. We have had strong issues when it comes to this kind of text message loans, that's what we call them in Sweden, right? SMS loan. I think that this is a market that's been growing. It's not a sound one. There's been now a suggestion in a review by the government to strengthen the regulation around this, to cap the maximum interest rates, to cap the maximum amount that you should pay to the lender. As maximum should be then the total sum that you actually borrow. So I think it's going in the right direction. But, this is also a consumer protection issue. We should be very, very skeptical to this kind of fast borrowing. And it's also something that happens in this kind of business cycle, right? We have seen it before, this advertising song back in the 90s saying that you borrow more and more and so on. So I'm definitely have the same worry as you have, and we're trying to do what we can within the scope of the legislation. But I'm glad to say that the legislation has actually been, hopefully, is going to be strengthened.
Okay, because the problem has been around for quite some time. The
SMS has been debated for quite some time. There has been a strengthening of the legislation, because now they need to have have the authorization by the FSA. So we have actually blocked a number of them.
Mm-hmm.
It's been strengthened, but it's going to be strengthened even further.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Anna?
Yeah. Of course, there is a risk with these types of loans. Mm. But I'd like to come back to this discussion on, because it's related to this question, actually, if there is a shortage of housing. I mean, construction is high since 1 year back, potentially 2 years, but it's been far below population growth for the past 20 years. And as I said, population will grow by 1 million in 7 years. So there will be a high demand for housing. And since there is no proper rental market, people will try to buy. Mm. And when we put a loan to value of 85%, so people need to have a 15% down payment. What do the households that don't have, can't get the money from the parents, for example, to buy? Well, they take out these higher risk consumer loans instead. Mm. And my concern is that if we keep on just pushing on the demand side, and there still be a big shortage of housing, people might move, and we might actually accelerate the growing shadow banking sector in Sweden. And that would be more risky than actually keeping the mortgages within the very solid banks that we have. And that discussion I don't see anywhere. Mm. So I would really like to, you know, raise a warning that we have to consider that people would just move their debt into more risky, and it would be the most vulnerable households who get the worst kind of loan, especially younger or poorer ones.
But it sounds like a rental market would be an even more
appropriate. Market, today there is, again, we have to consider the fact that we, at some point we have to create a functional renting market in Sweden. Yeah. I mean, it's absolutely absurd that neither people who have lower incomes can find housing in the larger cities and most municipalities, but even people, high-skilled, high-income earners, can't rent if they want to come and test a job in Stockholm for 2 or 3 years. Mm. So, I mean, we have, at some point, we're just going to have to fix this problem because we create problems in other sides of the economy. Mm. And again, the current situation is already causing a big trouble for the Swedish labor market. Both the companies can't find the right skills. It's difficult to recruit people. For example, if you want to add resources at the FSA, you want to find a great economist working at the Bank of England. You can't really pay that person enough to get them to come to Stockholm, can't find a rental property. And then they were forced into buying if they want to try to test to work in Sweden for 2 years. Mm. It's not reasonable, it's not worthy of a rich country like Sweden to have it like that. Mm. So, I mean, again, these two things are all, they're all interlinked. And my concern is that the demand in the coming years will be very, very high. And if we don't solve it in a better way, we'll just create the shadow banking system to meet that demand.
Mm. And the building construction we see now, will that meet the kind of demand that we see from the million coming in?
I do agree with Eric on that one, that currently, if you look at Stockholm, 70% of what is being built,
it's kind of fancy housing.
And they're very expensive.
Yeah.
And the need is much more for cheaper rental apartments, well, all types of rental apartments, but in particular in the coming years, it will be cheaper rental apartments needed.
Mm.
So that is that's an issue that we have to address as well.
Mm.
But we need the housing. That's it's very easy in the data to see that. You do need the housing.
Mm. Okay. Any more? Please, Craig.
Thanks. It's a very high-level discussion. I could offer just a few reactions. There was discussion about the role of monetary policy in the property market, and there was a discussion in the fund, the IMF, a number of years. We called it the leaning against the wind discussion. Should monetary policy be leaning against the wind? And I think until say 2014 or 2015, there was a sympathy for that. Even in Sweden, our reports had some openness to a modest compromise of the inflation target or being more patient on the inflation target. But we changed in 2015. It coincides with me taking the mission chief. I don't draw a strong linkage, but I guess from our perspective, what changed in 2015 was it looked like inflation expectations had de-anchored. So that was saying, well, that flexibility you had around monetary policy was reduced, and you had to go back and rebuild that credibility. So, and I guess another way to look at it was, well, what's the counterfactual? What's the counterfactual? You wouldn't have eased so much in 2015. Inflation would be lower. Expectations wouldn't have come back towards the target. And in fact, possibly your outlook is for rates to stay lower for longer, even longer than they are now. So, in some sense, not adhering to inflation target can possibly make the situation worse. That was the argument that we coupled with in 2015. I thought it was a really interesting point about the role of credit in the house price development. So it's exactly the point that we try to make in the report, that credit is not really driving prices. It's almost like it's responding to prices. Of course, prices can't go up and up and up without credit moving, but in the short to medium term, it's more like credit's responding to prices. Even if it's playing a relatively passive role, it doesn't mean it's not a problem. I mean, prices go up and eventually credit catches up, you end up with a lot of highly indebted people. So it doesn't, in some sense, the chain of causation doesn't really matter. You still have a problem that you need to look into. On the tax issue, if there was a property tax, I think we would look again at whether we were urging so strongly to phase out tax deductibility. I did sit down with our experts in our fiscal affairs department and, you know, tried to run this line about tax neutrality, and they made some very sophisticated arguments that may have been over my head, that there still was an issue. But I think the property tax would be a better solution. And some very interesting points around productivity. We see it as a really global issue, and it remains not very well understood. And given that we have some more, you know, sort of immediately pressing Swedish issues, we tend to focus on that. But thanks very much. Really, the shadow bank thing is a really interesting thing to think about. Thanks.
Thank you. There is room for one last question if there is no last question. Any last comment from our panel? Something you...
I have a last question to Erik. Earlier on this week, the Basel Committee met in Santiago discussing the revisions in the Basel III. Can you comment anything on that, or is it so that what happens in Santiago stays in Santiago?
I got the question from a journalist yesterday, and at first I said I don't know, and even if I knew, I wouldn't tell you.
Okay.
That's the same.
Okay, that's a topic I think we want to come back to.
Yeah.
Sort of what's,
sure thing.
When Erik wants to answer it. In that case, thank you very much for coming. Thank you, panel. Thank you, Craig. Thank you, Jesper.